Hey, good morning, Cathedral. How are you today? Good. You enjoying the fall that's finally here? Some of you over here aren't. That's okay. Forget Florida. Give me the seasons, man. I love the change of the seasons. I ate a pumpkin donut this morning. I mean, come on. It's great. But we were outside enjoying the fall weather yesterday. My kids biking up and down, you know, and I have three kids, and they're all a bit crazy in a wonderful way. And it never fails that one of them is going to fall down and skin their knee and get hurt and things like that. It's just part of being a kid. It's good, you know. And parents, moms and dads, react so differently to a hurt kid. Have you noticed that? Yes. No, he says. So, like, I grew up as just me and a brother. It was like a house of boys. And, you know, then I got these two boys who are my two oldest. And if one of them gets hurt, I'm like, you're fine. Come on. Walk it off. You know, rub some dirt in it. You'll be all right. Come on. It's okay. You know, that's kind of like the way that it doesn't work as well with Hope, my five-year-old little princess. Come on, rub some dirt in it. She's, you know, that kind of thing. But that's how I react when there's a hurt kid. Like, it's all right. You'll be fine. You'll be all right. Let's go. But my wife is very different. She's, come here. Let me give you a hug. Let me give you some comfort. Let me help you in that. Give you a big hug and squeeze you really tight. And it's okay. It's going to be all right. We react in very different ways. Now, which one of those draws to greater relationship? Which one brings greater comfort to the kid in the moment? You see, the nearness of the parent, the nearness of the one who provides security for the child, breeds relationship. It deepens our relationship together and the comfort that we can receive. The nearness of that parent gives that kid what they need in that moment, and it gives them the security to get back on the bike. And as we come close to Jesus, he gives us what we need in difficult moments, and he gives us the power to go out into a world on his behalf. Let's pray. Father, we are so grateful for this opportunity to worship you, the small, insignificant worship that we have just offered is so pales in comparison to who you are, Lord. It's everything that we have, and we would give you our whole lives, but it's not even an ounce of what you are worth, Lord. So we give you our lives, we give you these songs, we give you this time together. Lord, we thank you for your word and for the way that you instruct us, that we can see clearly who Jesus is, and we can experience him and be used by him. So, Lord, would you work in our time together today for your glory, for your namesake? In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, go ahead and get a hold of your Bible. Turn over to Mark chapter 3. We're going to be in Mark 3, 7 through 19. We're continuing in our series of the book of Mark. We've called it Just Jesus, Come and See. It's this beautiful picture of learning who Jesus is, discovering who is this Jesus that we all love and worship and follow. But it's this beautiful picture of not just learning about Jesus, but taking him to a world that desperately needs him. And it's my prayer today that we would be drawn closer to Jesus Christ through our time in his word, that we'd be deepened in our relationship with Jesus, more secure in our mission for Jesus. The call today for me and for you is to come close to Jesus. And that's the first point. Come close because Jesus wants to change you. Mark 3, beginning in verse 7, Jesus withdrew with his disciples to the sea, and a great crowd followed from Galilee and Judea and Jerusalem and Idumea and from beyond the Jordan and from around Tyre and Sidon. When the great crowd heard all that he was doing, they came to him. And he told his disciples to have a boat ready for him because of the crowd, lest they crush him. For he had healed many, so that all who had diseases pressed around him to touch him. And whenever the unclean spirits saw him, they fell down before him and cried out, "You are the Son of God." And he strictly ordered them not to make him known. See, in chapter 1, we see that Jesus is withdrawing up to the mountain by himself, alone, to pray. And we get this beautiful picture here that he's withdrawing now with his disciples, with the people who's following him. And even as he does that, you see that people come from all over. Many of them came from a very long distance. We have this map that we showed a few weeks ago. They came, you see in the text, they came from Galilee, from Judea, from Jerusalem, and Idumea and from beyond the Jordan. That's that portion that's east of the Jordan River. And it says, and around Tyre and Sidon. Now, this is like a map of Chicagoland. The people who live in northwest Indiana insist that they're part of Chicagoland. No, they're not. You're not even on the map. So Idumea is here. You'll see some of these areas, but Tyre and Sidon, they're so far north. They're on the coast of the Mediterranean Sea, north of Galilee. So people are coming from all around. Now remember, they're walking. This is an area of about 13,000 square miles, and they're walking days from the Wisconsin state line, from Indiana, from Galena, all the way down to Peoria. They're all walking to see what is happening, to see and to hear this Jesus of Nazareth. Many of them sacrifice to get to him. I gotta get to this guy. The crowd must have continued to grow, so much so that they need a boat just for a safety backup. You remember in chapter 2, they're in the house and the paralytic is lowered down because there's no room. The house is just so packed. But here it's grown so much that Jesus is a little fearful for his life even. Like, all right, I'm going in. I'm going to go talk with all these people. I'm going to preach to them. I'm going to heal them. I'm going to cast out demons. But listen, guys, you got to have a boat ready just in case, because this could get crazy. It's like the difference between red line at rush hour and like red line after a Cubs playoff game, if you know what I mean. It's crazy packed, but that's what's happening here. All of these people have to get towards Jesus, and I love his reaction in all of it. It's not, we got to get out of here. This is too busy. I don't know about you, but I've been in some places where I'm like, yeah, that's too long of a wait. I'm not waiting 2 hours for Au Cheval today. That's just too much. I gotta go. But Jesus doesn't do that. He presses in. He's like, all right, we need a bit of a backup plan in case it gets really crazy. But I'm going to minister to these people. I'm going to preach to these people. Remember our key verse, Mark 10:45, that he came to seek and to save the lost. He came to give his life as a ransom for many. He came not to be served, but to serve. And that's what Jesus is doing here. He's serving these people. And they come from so far away just to get a touch from Jesus. They just want to be close enough to where they can just even touch him. Because just a touch from Jesus is all it takes for life change to happen. Just a touch from the Master provides all that they would need. And maybe that's where you find yourself today, in need of a touch from Jesus, in need of a change that only Jesus Christ can bring, in need of healing, in need of mending, in need of comfort, in need of working, in need of a touch from Jesus Christ. And can I just tell you, it's so beautiful to me that Jesus's message to you and to me wouldn't be one of irritation for us wanting to be close to him. He's not irritated. He's not ticked off by all the crowds. He's like, no, this is what I'm here for. I'm here to be with these people, to preach to them, to proclaim to them, to heal them. Jesus's message to us wouldn't be irritation. It would be, come close. Come here. And even as all these amazing things happen here, it's so funny to me. Verse 11, and whenever the unclean spirits saw him, they fell down before him and cried out, you are the Son of God. This is so crazy to me. They're like, you're the Son of God. Don't hurt me. But that's where they find themselves. And then he does this. He's like, no, shut up. He says that, verse 12. And he strictly ordered them not to make him known. He's telling these demons who are being cast out not to make him known because the crowd has gotten so big here. Jesus' popularity is rising. Can you sense it? Back from chapter 1 where John the Baptist is declaring who this person is. And then Jesus shows up on the scene and continues to grow in popularity. And then he's in this house that's packed. And now he's out by the Sea of Galilee, out in the open places. And it's packed. Look, wall to wall people. He's gaining popularity so much that if Jesus doesn't control this, he needs to control his timeline because his message isn't one for the masses. His idea is to go to the cross for you and for me. He needs to get to the place where he's despised by many so that he can be crucified. We'll see that in chapter 15 and 16. But here, he's telling the demons, "You keep it down. It's not time yet. It's my time. It's not your time. Keep it down this week." But the beautiful thing is for us is the exact opposite is true. Jesus would never say, keep your mouth shut about what you've seen, what you've heard, what I've done in your life. We get the amazing privilege of seeing baptisms every single week and hearing people's story about what Jesus has done, how he's changed them, the bondage that he's broken, the lives that have been healed, the relationships that have been mended, the things that he has done in our midst and the stories that we have heard so far and the many that are left untold. It's astounding. And so here's a real specific application piece for this week. You ready? I want you to get on social media, you know, whatever you want, MySpace if you've still got it, I don't care. Get on social media, and I want you to share specifically how Jesus has changed you this week. You don't got to start a fight, you know, choose to read the comments, choose to suffer. Like, I don't know that I would go into all the things like that, but just clearly, this is who I was. This is what Jesus has done. If you want like a model for that, what we do for all of the baptisms is we say, it's just a couple of questions. It's tell us about when you gave your life to Jesus Christ. And then how has your life been different because of following Jesus Christ? And then the last one is why do you want to get baptized? Which you're not going to say on social media because you're not getting baptized there. But if you just want a pattern like that, I was, but Jesus, now I'm. It's a great passage, a great way to do that, a great pattern. And so get on social media this week. Tweet that out to people, just how Jesus has changed you. I was broken, and he mended me. I was suffering, and he brought me comfort. I was lost, and he found me. I was a selfish mess, and Jesus Christ changed my heart to grow in love towards other people. However he's changed you, use that message to proclaim him, because this beautiful thing that we see, we've talked about it a little bit, this beautiful thing that we see in the book of Mark is this pattern. It's the come and see who Jesus is. Experience who Jesus is and be changed by him, but then not just come and see, but go and tell. Go tell other people about Jesus Christ. And that's the message for me and for you from the book of Mark, is to come and see how Jesus has changed us, but then to go and tell others all that he has done for us. And, you know, I've always had, like, when I look at this passage, there's this great crowd coming before him, and they're all around him. To be honest, I've always had a bit of a mild frustration, this little bit of an irritation by all the crowds that come. You know, we've got the feeding of the 5,000 later and the feeding of the 4,000. It's like, these people are just coming to get stuff from him. These people who are coming here are just coming because they want to be healed or because they have a demon and they want that casted out, or that's what they're coming for. But I was really convicted this week because that's not how Jesus sees them. He doesn't see them as irritants. He doesn't see them as problems. He doesn't see them as like less important than the guys we're going to talk about in a minute. He's just come to me. That's what he says to all of these people. And even though I may be irritated by the large crowds of people in some of the restaurants, Jesus doesn't have that. And isn't it true that that's how most of us came to Jesus? We didn't come to him with it all put together and look at this great resume that I have and what I can do for you, Lord. We came broken. We came a mess. We came in need of salvation. We came hurting. We came discouraged, but Jesus changed us. You see, it's not wrong to come to Jesus because of what you might get from him. It's just wrong for that to be the only reason you're with Jesus. And that's what he calls us to do, calls us to greater closeness in him. We're to come close because Jesus wants to change you, but also to come close because Jesus wants a relationship with you. Let's pick it back up in verse 13. And he went up on the mountain and called to him those whom he wanted, and they came to him. And he appointed 12, whom he also named apostles, that they might be with him and that he might send them out to preach and have authority to cast out demons. Jesus is retreating from the crowds at this point and going with just his disciples. It's so beautiful to me, these two groups that both come to him. The words are the same. They came to him. We see in verse 8 that the crowds came to him because they heard all of the amazing things that he was doing. They wanted to get near to Jesus, and that's not wrong. But these disciples came to him, these followers of Jesus came to him because he called them, because he wanted them near him. It says he called those whom he desired. Now, I had read this text so many times thinking, oh yeah, it's the 12. But if you actually read it carefully, you look at some of the parallels in Luke 6 and some other places, he calls a lot more people than that and then calls the 12 out of that. So what he's doing here is he's calling all of the people who are sincerely following Jesus at this point. Scholars would tell us that it's probably several hundred that actually follow him there. And so, but there's thousands and thousands of people who've come from all around. And then Jesus takes the hundred or so people who are following him and says, let's go away a little bit. I want you to be with me. That's what Jesus is calling them to, these that he desired. And the amazing thing here to me is that it's those whom he desired. Jesus wanted to be with them. He wanted a relationship with them. The all-sufficient creator of the universe, the savior of the world, desires to be with us. That is crazy. He doesn't need you. He doesn't need me. But he wants a relationship with us. And Jesus wants a relationship with you. Listen, friends, in the hundreds of people that were there in that place and in the hundreds of people that are here in this room, don't miss the fact that Jesus desires a relationship with you. Not just us. Us is true, but not just us. He desires you. All of your mess, all of my mess, he wants us to be with him. He would say, come close. Come close to me. Let's be together. You have to let yourself feel the weight of that. He doesn't just want all of us. He wants you. He wants a personal relationship. All of your mess and all of your skinned knees and your bruises and your shortcomings and your hurt and your brokenness and your loneliness and your depression and your fear and your anxiety and your stress, Jesus still wants to be with you. It's an amazing truth. But we have to respond to this invitation to come close to him. Jesus desired them, and they came to him. And even though we may grasp the amazing reality that Jesus wants a relationship, sometimes we're too busy or too caught up in our own lives to take that step, caught up in our own pride, our own selfishness, that we don't actually come to him. And if you're lacking in strength, if you're hurting, if you're stressed and burdened and at the end of yourself and not sure where the power is going to come from, come to Jesus. He's calling you and he wants a deeper relationship with you. Because all that we are, all that we have, it starts and it's fueled by a relationship with Jesus Christ. If you're trying to live a life of following Jesus and doing all of the things for Jesus without deepening your relationship with him, you're attempting to drive a car with no gas in it. Jesus is the start and he's the fuel of our work for him. If you're seeking to work for Jesus and to act for Jesus and to carry his message to the watching world that desperately needs him, but you're doing that without a deep and a vibrant, continually coming to Jesus for a deepening of relationship, you will always get to a place of burnout and lack of joy. You will always get to a place of dryness. You will always get to a place of hurting and feeling like I don't have enough to keep going. You will always feel that way. But our call today, our call from this text is to be with Jesus before we do for Jesus. Before I'm to act out my life in a way that honors him. Before I'm supposed to act out my life in a way that serves him and serves other people and gives myself as a ransom for many as he has done. Before I do all of that, I need to be with Jesus. We come close because Jesus wants to change us. We come close because Jesus wants a relationship with us. And we come close because Jesus wants to send you. Jesus wants to send you. It says, I want to begin reading again in 14. We're going to back up just a couple verses. We'll read 14 to 19. And he appointed 12 whom he also named apostles so that they might be with him, and he might send them out to preach and have authority to cast out demons. He appointed the 12, Simon, to whom he gave the name Peter, James, the son of Zebedee, and John, the brother of James, to whom he gave the name Boanerges, that is, sons of thunder, Andrew and Philip and Bartholomew, and Matthew and Thomas, and James, the son of Alphaeus, and Thaddeus, and Simon the Cananean, and Judas Iscariot, who betrayed him. You see, he appointed these 12 that they might be with him and that he might send them out. Now, I want to take just a couple of minutes and run through really briefly who these guys are, because I think it's really helpful for understanding what happens later in the book of Mark and understanding all of the Gospels and even the book of Acts that we, Lord willing, are turning to in the future as a church. A few of these guys, Simon Peter, you know this guy. He's always, 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 every list, he is the first person named. He's an impulsive man of action. He's sort of the, like, ready, fire, aim. That's who Peter is. And you got to love Peter for that, but you also got to be irritated with him from time to time. Especially those of us who are, like, a little more methodical about things, we're like, just, Peter, take a second and think about what you're going to say. He's the guy who, you know, everybody knows what he's thinking at the same time he does because the words just came out of his mouth. He hasn't taken the time to think, and we'll see tons of this, but he becomes a grounded, steadfast leader of the apostles. And this is why Jesus gave him the name Peter, which means rock, which would have been really funny at the time because he was anything but a rock at this point. He's all over the place, but Jesus is like, I'm calling you Peter because not so much now and not so much tomorrow, but in the future, you will be a rock for my church. And so that's who Peter is. He's the leader there. He was martyred in Rome. He was crucified upside down because when they went to try to crucify him, he said, I'm not worthy to die the same way Jesus was. Put me upside down. And he was killed on a cross. James, the son of Zebedee, and John are always listed next. James is potentially the first disciple who was martyred for Jesus Christ in the early 40s by Herod Agrippa. And then his brother, John here, he's the longest surviving apostle. He's the only one other than Judas that was not killed for his faith. He was exiled on the island of Patmos and died there at an old age, but he was still persecuted for Jesus, but was not actually killed. This is the person who, throughout the book of John, refers to himself as the disciple whom Jesus loved. And this is an amazing difference between here because they're called the Boanerges or Sons of Thunder. Now, Peter was given this name because of what he might become. They were given this name because they were irrational and brash and hot-headed and judgmental. You always see them like, can we be first? Can I sit on your right? Can he sit on your left? It's us, right? They're always doing that. And so he's like, calm down, Sons of Thunder. It's not exactly as much of a positive name as Peter is, but it's a beautiful thing that John was changed so much that later on in his life, all he sees is, I don't matter. What matters is Jesus loves me. That's an amazing truth, that's where he comes to the place of just calling himself, he doesn't even use his name, just the disciple Jesus loved. That's all I need to be known by. Andrew is the brother of Peter. He's a disciple of John the Baptist at first. He's often seen as bringing people to Jesus Christ. He was killed on an X-shaped cross after leading a woman to the faith whose husband didn't approve of her being a Christian, and he had him killed for it. But the crazy thing about Andrew's story, he's always bringing people to Jesus, but here as he's being crucified on an X-shaped cross, he hung there for 2 days before he died. And the whole time, history tells us that he was preaching the gospel to every person that walked past as he hung there and died. This is incredible. Constantly bringing people to Jesus. That's who Andrew is. Philip is from Bethsaida, the hometown of Peter and Andrew's. They probably grew up playing, what sport was back then? Soccer, probably? I don't know. But they see him, we see him lacking understanding oftentimes, as is true of all of the 12. Later would be a great evangelist. We see him leading the Ethiopian eunuch to Christ through the word of God. Philip was a great evangelist there. Bartholomew, he began to follow Jesus because of Philip. This is also the guy named Nathanael. He's the guy that Jesus said, "Behold, an Israelite indeed, in whom there is no deceit." That's who he was talking about. It's this guy Nathaniel. That's in John 1:47. Matthew, we know about Matthew. Levi is a tax collector. So this guy was sitting in his booth collecting money for the Romans. Now remember, the people of Israel, the people of God, were in captivity. They were in occupation, that is, from the Romans. So no one liked the Romans around. And here's Matthew, this guy, like, collecting money for them and keeping some of it. He was despised for that. He also wrote the Gospel of Matthew. Thomas, his nickname was Didymus, which means the twin. How would you like that? You're just called twin all the time. Come here, twin, you know? But that's what he's called. We call him Doubting Thomas, but this is also the Thomas, when they're going to Jerusalem, who's the first to say, "Let us go with him that we may also die with him." And he took the gospel to India and was martyred there. James, the son of Alphaeus, there's not a ton known about him, but his mother was one of the Marys who later followed Jesus. Thaddeus is also called Judas, the son of James, or in John just calls him Judas, not Iscariot. Like, not the guy who betrayed him, the other Judas. That's about what we know about Thaddeus. Simon the Cananean, or a better translation, is actually Simon the Zealot. He was an anti-Roman revolutionary. So think about him and Matthew hanging out in the same crew for 3 years together. The guy who's collecting money, helping the Romans, and the guy whose whole life goal was to destroy the Romans. They're together in all this. And then last, always mentioned last in every list in the gospel, is Judas Iscariot. We know him because he betrayed Jesus. Jesus knew that he would do so. The book of John tells us that. He also acted as the treasurer. He would keep all the money for all the guys, and scripture tells us that he would steal from all of that. And of course, he is the one who's materialistic, a thief, and eventually denies Jesus. But it's an amazing thing to me that Jesus knew that, and he still calls him as one of the 12. The thing that I think is so unique about this group is they're all odd choices. If you're going to turn the world upside down, really, you pick this group, there's a bunch of fishermen, there's an anti-Roman guy, and there's a pro-Roman guy, and there's this guy who's a thief, and he's extremely materialistic, and you know that he's going to betray you. Jesus calls all of them together. They were uneducated, they were untrained, they were uninfluential. There's all different types of people, but all of them are called to Jesus, and it's interesting to me that all of them have the same job to do. They're all being sent out to preach and to work for Jesus Christ. In Acts 4, we'll later hear, the religious leaders would recognize all of these guys as, not as trained people, not as sophisticated. They would recognize that they were with Jesus. Sort of like, oh, I could see in the way that you act. I could see in the things that you say. I could see in the way that you treat people that you are with that Jesus of Nazareth. I dearly hope people say that about me. I hope that they would say, I don't know, he's a little weird. He likes coffee too much. I don't know. He makes fun of Elvin too much, you know. But I can tell he's been with Jesus. That's what I want for my life. But that's what they had. Jesus spent more and more time with these 12 as he moves closer and closer to the cross. Here in the book of John, or the book of Mark, we'll continue to see that Jesus spends less time with the crowds and more time with his followers. Less time ministering and teaching, and he still does some of that, but less and less. And more time teaching in parables where the meaning is hidden to the outside but is clear to the disciples. More time investing in them, explaining to them. More time working through them. And these 12 had no idea what the next few years would have in store for them. They knew Jesus is this great teacher and this one who did miracles, and I don't know, there's something about him, I just want to be around him more, and he called me to him, and I want to be in relationship with him, so I'll go to him. They had no idea the miracles that they would continue to see. They had no idea the opposition that they would feel from the people that they respected the most in that area. They had no idea what they would see through all of that. And we will see throughout the book of Mark, because a major theme is discipleship failure. The way that the disciples continually, like, don't get it. And some of the people in the crowds get it. They have faith and they're moving along. And the disciples just totally miss what Jesus is saying. We'll see all of that. They didn't know what lie ahead for them. Jesus' death and resurrection. They didn't know as they came to him up on this mountain that in a couple years, this guy's going to be brutally killed on a cross. And then he's going to rise again. They didn't know any of this. They didn't know the thousands of people that would come to faith in Jesus Christ throughout the book of Acts because of their work and their preaching for Jesus. And they didn't know that every single one of them would be killed because of this Jesus that they're following. But they came to him. All different types of guys, and they all came to him. Listen, you don't have to have a pedigree. You don't have to have previous experience to have a positive impact for Jesus Christ. You just have to come near to him. You just have to be with him and be sent out by him, and that's what these are called to. Keisha, you have been called to Jesus, and he's sending you out. Stephen and Amy, you've been called to Jesus, and he's sending you out. Mark Sawyer, you've been called to Jesus, and he's sending you out. There is great power and impact that's found for Jesus Christ when we are found in him, when we're deepening that relationship with Jesus Christ, when we're following where he calls to and where we go where he sends us. And that's what these 12 do. You see, three things are happening with these 12. First, they're being with Jesus. We have a fun little diagram that explains this. First, they're with Jesus. They're being with Jesus. But they're not just with Jesus. They're called into this relationship. They're hanging out with these other 11 guys, like, for the next couple of years. They're really getting to know. Some of you who have been in a small group, you, like, really get to know the people in your small group. Bumps and bruises and great things and all of it together. But that's what these guys are experiencing. They're being called into a community to be together, to be with Jesus. But then the third thing that they're called to is to serve for Jesus. They're not just called to be with Jesus. They're not just called to be in community with other people who are following Jesus. They're called to go do something for Jesus. And there's power in the combo here. All three of these are critically important. We need all of them for this beautiful combo to come to place. One of the other things that I love about fall is my wife made that last year. She makes, if you were at the potluck last week, you probably saw the cornucopia cake. My wife makes these amazing cakes. And one of the ones that she did last fall, I wrote it down because it was so amazing. It was a pumpkin cake with cookie crunch, cream cheese frosting, and dark chocolate eggnog ganache. It was as good as it sounds. And man, I love each one of those things. Pumpkin, good. Cookie crunch, good. Cream cheese frosting, good. Dark chocolate eggnog, good. But can I just tell you, when you get a forkful of all of the things together, there is power in the combo. I would even say there is perfection in the combo. And we're called to all of these things. We're called to be with Jesus. We're called to be in community with other followers of Jesus, but we're called to be sent by Jesus. Without Jesus, we're missing the power. We're missing the authority that he gives us. Without community, we're missing the accountability that we could have. We're missing the care for one another that we could have. And without service or appointment, we're missing the purpose for which we are here. Power, impact, joy come in the combo. And we are designed to have all three. There's a lot of ministries and a lot of churches that talk about discipleship and an individual kind of thing. And I think that that's true. Like, have you been discipled by somebody? It's this idea that I'm sitting down at a coffee shop, probably because that's what I do, sitting down at a coffee shop with somebody who's further along in the faith, and they're opening God's word and telling me how they follow Jesus. Sort of the imitate me as I imitate Jesus Christ. And that's a beautiful thing. I'm not negating that. But so often we focus on that, like, who discipled you? Who discipled you? Who was the person that? But the crazy thing is when we look at God's word, that's not what we see. They're with Jesus to go do something. It's not just this, let's sit at a coffee shop every week on Tuesday at 6 in the morning and spend some time studying God's word. And that's good, but that's just the beginning place. That's not where you live. That's where you start. And all of us are called to step out and to actually do something for Jesus, to spend time with Jesus and to do ministry for him. Paul did this with Timothy and Titus. He like brings this guy, these guys along. They honestly do a bunch of grunt work for him at the beginning, but they're learning and they're growing because they're in community together, and then they're sent out to go plant churches. A huge part of discipleship is being sent by Jesus. And if you're missing that piece, you're missing a huge part of what it means to follow Jesus. What football team practices running plays without ever playing a Sunday game? What student studies flashcards without ever reading or speaking the language? What musician sits there and practices scales without ever playing a song? We were meant to do something for the Lord because of our relationship with Jesus Christ. He didn't need these guys, but he wanted to work through them. He doesn't need us, but he wants to work through us. He calls us to a greater ministry for him, to a watching world that desperately needs Jesus Christ. And that would be the call for you and for me, is to be not just in a relationship with Jesus, deepening that relationship with Jesus, but also to be sent by Jesus, to be working for him. We sometimes say, be the hands and feet of Jesus Christ, and that's a fun little thing to put on a little Hallmark card, but it's actually like to go minister for him, to do the things that Jesus is teaching and to act in a way that honors him, to care for a world, because there are people all around us, not just in Jesus' day. There are people all around us who need the message of Jesus Christ, who need to be brought close, not just for life change, but brought close into a relationship with Jesus Christ and brought close to be sent out for Jesus. As we come to the close, I want to open up the front of the church. You know, there's a lot that's here about us being brought close to Jesus, and the force of it all is a call from Jesus to come close. It's not a go do it. It's a just come to me. It's the mom getting the kid with the skint knee. Just come close to me. Come here. Because that relationship gives us what we need in the moment and calls us to greater things. It calls us to get back on the bike. It calls us to go out and to serve for him. So we're going to go into a time of prayer. So if you would bow your heads and close your eyes. And as we look at this passage, as you hear about all that Jesus is doing, if you feel that you're in deep need of a change, come now to the front. We're going to spend some time in prayer. I'm not going to make you say anything or get up on stage with a microphone. But the church is open, and it's a place where we can come to Jesus. Allow your walking forward, your physical coming to the front, to symbolize a spiritual coming and returning to Jesus. Come because you're in need of change. Come because you want a deeper relationship with Jesus. Come because you want to be sent. By coming forward, you're signifying that you want to come closer. You need to be closer. You're committed to being closer to Jesus Christ. As we draw near, he promises to draw near to you. So as we sing, come forward as we pray. He is waiting. Come now.